How do flowers pollinate? Watch now to find out.
Welcome to Feed Your Brain.
Since this video is packed full of information to feed your brain, here is the table of contents to help you with all of this information. You can view the timestamps in the description below to jump right to a topic. First off is, how does a plant grow seeds in order to grow more plants or fruit? Through pollination. There are two types of pollination. Cross-pollination, which requires an agent, such as honeybees. And self-pollination. An example of cross-pollination is with the apple blossom. Start with a red delicious apple tree blossom. This requires an apple tree of a different species nearby to pollinate, within 100 feet. Then we look at the parts of an apple tree flower. Pollinators are attracted to the colors and fragrance of the flower and the sweet smell of the nectar. Apple trees are called self-unfruitful because they need pollen from another type of apple tree. The agent, such as a honeybee, needs to feed from one type of apple tree, then travel to another type of apple tree within 100 feet and feed on nectar. If you turn an apple upside down, you can match up its parts with an apple flower. Another example of cross-pollination. Stamen on its own flower. Pistil on its own flower. Monoecious plant. Both male and female flowers are on the same plant. You only need one plant to obtain fruit. This includes the Gourd family. The Gourd family all grow on vines. These are vine vegetables or vine fruit. Watch my other video on fruit versus vegetables. What is the difference? This includes squash or zucchini, pumpkin, cucumber, watermelon, cantaloupe, and gourds. Dioecious plants. Di means two. One plant is only of male flowers. One plant is only of female flowers. Therefore, it takes two plants to pollinate. Then there is self-pollination. Tomato plant is an example. Each flower contains all parts necessary for pollination. Therefore, more than one plant is not needed. But self-pollination doesn't always work out. The flower needs some type of movement, such as wind. An agent, such as a bumblebee's movement from flapping its wings, or movement of your hand to shake it, or a soft brush to brush the pollen around. That was a long table of contents. Let's get started. What is pollination? How do plants create seeds, which then reproduce into more plants? This is through pollination. There are two types of pollination. There is cross-pollination, and there is self-pollination. Cross-pollination requires an agent to take pollen from one flower and carry it to another flower. The agent can be the wind, but that is not common as that is difficult to achieve. And the agent can be an animal. The most common pollinator is the honeybee. Hummingbirds are also pollinators. Beetles, such as ladybugs, are pollinators, and not only do beetles drink the nectar, but they also eat the petals and other parts of the flower. Moths are pollinators. And did you also know that bats are pollinators? They pollinate over 300 types of fruits, such as mangoes, bananas, and guavas. And the other type of pollination is self-pollination. This does not require any agent, which means self-pollination doesn't need the help from such animals as honeybees and bats to pollinate. Here is an example of an apple blossom, which relies on cross-pollination with a different species of apple tree nearby. This process really is amazing. You have the petals which make the outer form of the flower and attract insects to it. Then you have these stems, which are called the stamen. And at the base of the petals are the sweet nectar secretions that the pollinator insects are attracted to. Let's look even closer at the stamen. The stem here is called the filament. This top pod or top round part is called the anther. Just one of these round parts is called the pollen sac. Let's cut this one open, remove the top, and look inside. This is the pollen sac, because this is where the pollen grains come from. The pollen grains start out as microsporangium and then mature and grow to become the pollen grains that are released onto the outer pollen sacs, or anthers. Now back at the apple blossom. Let's now look at this middle part. This entire middle part is called the pistil. And it's made up of all of these parts. At the top is an opening into a tube. The top opening is called the stigma. The long tube is called the style. And the entire bottom round area is called the ovary. Within the ovary are many little ovules. Insects that feed on nectar are called pollinators, such as honeybees. Honeybees are attracted to the scent and colors of flowers, and fly down and land on the flower, and reach into the bottom and drink up the nectar. So as the honeybee is feeding on the nectar, the honeybee's body is brushing up against the anthers, which are covered in pollen grains. The pollen grains then get stuck all over the honeybee, because the honeybee is covered in tiny hairs, so grains of pollen easily stick to the honeybee. Then after feeding on this flower, the honeybee flies away to feed on another flower. Take note that this flower blossom is from a red delicious apple tree. Apple trees are called self-unfruitful. This means that pollen from one flower of the same type of apple tree, such as this red delicious apple tree, will not pollinate any other flower from the same type of apple tree. The apple tree will only be fertilized from pollen from another type of apple, such as this Granny Smith apple tree. This means that the honeybee that just fed on the flower's nectar from the red delicious apple tree also needs to fly to another nearby apple tree but of a different type, like this Granny Smith apple tree. And this Granny Smith apple tree needs to be nearby, within 100 feet of the first tree. So now the honeybee has landed on a flower blossom, which is now on a Granny Smith apple tree. And look what happened here. A pollen grain that was on this honeybee got stuck to the top of this flower's pistil, at the stigma. So now a pollen grain from the red delicious apple tree is now on the stigma of this Granny Smith apple tree. Then look what happened here. Pollen from this Granny Smith apple tree flower blossom got stuck on the back leg of the honeybee. So now this honeybee has pollen here from the previous red delicious apple tree flower blossom, plus the honeybee now has this additional pollen from this Granny Smith apple tree flower blossom. And the honeybee is feeding off of the nectar at the bottom of the flower petals. Once this honeybee is done here, it lifts off and flies away to another flower blossom. And as it flew off, look what it left here, another pollen grain from the red delicious apple flower blossom, which is now also stuck on the top of the pistil at the stigma. Now one of the pollen grains here at the top of the pistil, at the opening of the stigma, makes its way down the tube of the pistil, which is called the style. And the pollen grain then makes its way into the base, which is called the ovary. The pollen grain then makes its way to an ovule, where it now has pollinated this flower blossom. So now the ovary grows into an apple, and the ovules grow into the seeds of the apple. And if you turn an apple upside down, you can match up the parts of the apple with the parts of the apple tree flower blossom. At the base of the apple is the stigma. Then you see the seeds in the middle, which used to be the ovules, and then you see the stem of the apple, which used to be the stem of the flower, which is called the pedicel. And that is how an apple tree's flower blossom becomes pollinated and then turns into an apple. And that is amazing. So that apple that you enjoy eating, next time, hold it upside down, and imagine it first being an apple blossom flower on an apple tree. And now imagine for the flower to be able to turn into that apple, a pollinator, typically a honeybee, had to first feed from a flower on a different type of apple tree, and that other type of apple tree flower had to be within 100 feet from the flower on the apple tree where the apple grew that you are now holding. And pollen from that other apple tree nearby had to stick to the honeybee. And then the pollen on the honeybee had to come off, and stick to the stigma on the flower of the apple that you are holding. Then the pollen from the other apple tree had to travel down the pistil's tube, or style, to pollinate an ovule. And this is how cross-pollination of an apple flower works. Without a pollinator, such as a honeybee, without another type of apple tree within 100 feet, this apple would not have become an apple at all. That was an example of cross-pollination. There is another type of flower requiring cross-pollination, but with this type of flower, the stamen is alone on its own flower, and the pistil is alone on its own flower, and both are on the same plant. This is called a monoecious plant, and mono means one, so monoecious is one plant with both the male and female flowers on it. Therefore, you only need one plant to obtain fruit. This type of flower, or monoecious plant, includes the gourd family, which are vine vegetables, or you can call them, technically, vine fruits. Watch my video on fruit versus vegetable, what is the difference? To learn why so many vegetables are actually fruit. The gourd family includes squash, pumpkin, cucumber, watermelon, cantaloupe, and gourds. So now imagine that each of these fruits, or vegetables if you prefer, grew out of a swollen ovary from the female flower on a vine. And with monoecious plants, such as the gourd family of plants, you only need one plant to obtain fruit. So for example, on this vine, here is the male flower. You can identify this flower as the male flower because of two features. First, you will see just the stamen in the middle, with the top part, the anther, covered in pollen. Second, which is easier to see, is you'll see just the thin stem, or pedicel, below the petals. To identify the female flower, there are also two features to look for. First, you will see the stigma is spread out and has multiple parts to it. Then second, which is easier to see, if you'll see the bulge of the ovary below the petals. So for the female flower to be pollinated, a pollinator, such as a bee, is needed to first land on the male flower, feed off of its nectar, and get pollen from the anther stuck to its body. Then the pollinator's next stop needs to be the female flower, where it also feeds off of the nectar, and the pollen that is stuck to the bee's body needs to come over and stick to the female flower's stigma. After a successful pollination, then the fruit of the plant swells up and grows into the unique fruit that it has become. So from the little female flower, you end up with this large pumpkin. Now isn't that amazing? Or from the female flower, you end up with a large watermelon, if it's a watermelon vine. Or zucchini on the zucchini vine. Or cucumber. Or cantaloupe. Or gourds. All of these are vine fruits, or vegetables. Now let's look at dioecious plants. D is the Greek prefix that means two, so with dioecious plants, you need two separate plants for pollination. And why is that? Because female flowers only grow on one plant, and male flowers only grow on one plant. And because fruit and seeds only grow from a female flower's ovary, if you have a female dioecious plant, you'll need a male dioecious plant nearby. What types of plants are dioecious? For vegetable-bearing plants, these are asparagus, spinach, and yam. And for fruit-bearing plants, there is kiwifruit, papaya, and date palm. Other examples of dioecious plants are willow trees, mistletoe, and poplar trees. Now let's look at self-pollination. Let's look at the tomato plant as an example, because the tomato plant is a self-pollinator. Self-pollinating means that the flowers on the plant contain all parts necessary to fertilize its ovules, so therefore, more than one plant is not needed for reproduction. Let's look at the tomato blossom to understand the anatomy better of a self-pollinator flower. Here are the petals. Here is what's called the staminal cone. Here is the stamen of a typical flower, which is the thin filament, and on top is the anther, which is full of the pollen grain. But on the tomato flower, the stamen are all stuck together, and form a cone shape as shown here, so the tomato flower's stamen is called a staminal cone, to more accurately describe how it really is structured. And at the top is called the anther cone, because, again, the anthers are not separate like you see in typical flowers, but these anthers are squished together in a tube cone shape, so it's called the anther cone. And here is where the pollen grains are released from the anther cone. The location of the pollen grains on a typical anther are located here. To be a self-pollinating flower, this tomato blossom also needs the ability to make fruit, which is a tomato, so where is the rest of this flower? Let's look inside the staminal cone to find out. Here is a cutaway view of the staminal cone, and there is something else inside. Let's zoom in and take a closer look. Inside the staminal cone is the pistil, which is this entire part. At the top of the pistil is called the stigma, and there is an opening there. Then this tube is called the style, and being a tube, it is hollow inside. At the base here is the ovary, this is where the fruit is made. And inside the ovary are the ovules, which after fertilization turn into the seeds of the fruit. So the anther cone secretes the pollen grains, and then the pollen grains sit outside on the anther cone. Then, this self-pollinating tomato blossom is supposed to somehow, on its own, get these pollen grains into this stigma. And then hopefully from the stigma, the pollen grains will travel down the style and into the ovary, and then combine with an ovule to turn the ovary into a fruit, and the ovules into seeds. But this blossom has no arms or hands, so how will the pollen grains be able to perform all of this movement on its own? This is the limitation of self-pollinating blossoms. Because of the limitation of the flower, it might not be able to pollinate itself, and then there won't be any tomatoes produced. So then what is best for this self-pollinating flower? This flower needs some type of movement. What can help this flower to move? It can be the wind, if this plant is outside. It can also be a pollinator, such as a bumblebee. And with this tomato blossom, the bumblebee helps move the flower by its wings vibrating on it, and then that causes the staminal cone to vibrate as well, which then helps to release the pollen from the anther cone. Another way to move this flower is for a hand to shake it. Yes, you could shake or flick the flower with your hand. You could also brush the pollen around with a soft brush. But imagine having to shake or brush every single tomato blossom by hand? That would be a lot of work, especially if you want to grow a lot of tomatoes. We just learned about self-pollination and cross-pollination. What are some examples of self-pollinating flowers? These are typically plants with smaller flowers that used self-pollination. This includes peanuts, apricots, tomatoes, though we just learned the challenges with tomatoes self-pollinating. Also, wheat, oats, rice, and beans. Also, lettuce, peas. Corn is pollinated by the wind. Certain cherry trees, sweet cherry Stella and compact Stella self-pollinate. Peach trees are self-pollinating. Annual flowers are often self-pollinating because they need to pollinate quickly because of their limited lifespan. Annuals only last one annual cycle, believe it or not. Some annuals that are self-pollinating are zinnias, cosmos, larkspur, most marigolds, most sunflowers, geraniums, cornflowers, begonias, petunias, nasturtiums, snapdragons, anilisms. What are some examples of cross-pollinating flowers? Carrots, onion, garlic, cauliflower. Most cherry trees require cross-pollination. Most pear trees need cross-pollination from nearby common trees. How do flowers pollinate? I hope you learned a lot from this video. Please hit like and subscribe. That helps a lot. Thank you for watching.
Feed your brain.